Friday night lights, Friday night lecture, it's great, and I'm super honored to introduce Enrique tonight. Enrique Ruiz Gelly is well known. I think you all know his work, and you'll see new work tonight that no one else has seen. It's a premiere, as it were, in a city that has many of them. For new work. Of course, he's from Barcelona, and he has been a teacher for quite a while, but is now teaching Unit 18 with Simon Taylor from the graphic design group Tomato, or Tomato, depending on where you're from. Their Unit 18, he's been doing that since 2010, and he's also since 2012 running the self-sufficient community project at the Institute for Advanced Architecture, the IAC, in Barcelona, and divides his time between that and also his office, of course, which you know, which is called Cloud9. You know, like a lot of national cultures of architecture, there are traditions and histories in Americans. We have them in the particular tradition and lineage, especially in the 20th century, of Spanish architects, as you know, runs, let's say, from somebody like Gaudí, whose work deals in organizational phenomena, material phenomena, formal and geometric phenomena that is related to nature at some level, to somebody like Alejandro de la Sota, you know, the pinnacle modernist of the 1960s who practiced, I think, like Spanish architects do, with a certain amount of faith in the ideas of modernism, but always played it out with the kind of soul and life, not a clinical modernism. If you think about that, you know, track, you know, one might be the wild experimentation becoming more and more disciplined over time in the 20th century. Enrique is somewhere in that world, but at the same time, I'm hesitant to claim any more kind of sense of lineage of his work, because I think he's definitely an outlier and a unique individual. So if you take the issue of form and material and energy, sustainability, culture, art, progress, I think it really means that Enrique is almost like a polymath who's somehow managing to do many things, do them well, not be a dilettante, and fold it into a complex practice that I think is very unique. Not only in Spain, but I think in global architecture. I think also that's a challenge to do, because we also always make decisions about people's ideology, you know, based on their relationship to issues of energy and sustainability. It's a lightning rod. It's a fault line. It's a political agenda. It can be very divisive. And I think Enrique is indifferent to that level of political divisiveness and incorporates the project as an experimental discipline, as you'll see tonight. On a personal note, if there's one building I show more than any to my students, and if you've had me, you saw it, it's Enrique's Media ICT building in Barcelona, the Seafoam Green project that pushed innovation at the level of construction envelope, and even still today, questions about program. I think he is a prospector and a traveler. He's coming from a month in the desert and visiting places like Arcosanti that we may think are irrelevant, and he finds deeply connected to contemporary ideas, an anthropologist, an expert in urban forensics, and so many other things. I guess let's not forget one thing, that Cloud9, we don't use that term in America very much anymore. It's a little bit from another era, like I'm on Cloud9. When was the last time you said I'm on Cloud9? But let's log out. Okay. I'm on cloud nine. That means I'm in a state of euphoria. So I think it's not coincidental, obviously, that you named your office cloud nine. And I think we're going to get into a state of euphoria here on Friday night. So please welcome Enrique Ruiz-Jelly. Thank you.
From Grey Canyon to Antelope Canyon. We have been in Taliesin Way, we have been in Arco Santi. This morning at the Eames House, I cannot talk. I'm supposed to do a lecture and I cannot even talk. Wow. But I do have to talk. So, as it's a Friday night, what are you doing here on a Friday night in LA? Something like this is the wrong agenda. But anyway, let's do it. So we're here, let's do it. Thanks, Neil, for this welcome. I take your words quite seriously. As you said, we are in this liquid reality, we are in all together, and somehow, I was here in the CCA doing a Gregglin show. You may be aware of this CCA Gregglin show. And I did some selfies. And it's a show, so you get a selfie and a coffee cup. That's how we live together in a quite a friendship way. But we do know that we are in a critical situation. We do know that architecture is the number one cause of global warming. We do know that architects are the number one cause of global warming. We do know that 80% of our energy is burned in cities. We do know 40% of the CO2 emissions are buildings. So once you know. And that inception came to me by Jeremy Rifkin. So tonight is not a lecture, it's an inception. Okay? Maybe. Our reality looks like that. I do believe that, yeah, there is an economy of knowledge already happening. This is the 22 Arroba district in Barcelona. The socialist agenda there was, could we do a Silicon Valley and a social housing at the same block, at the same place, 50 meters away, one thing to another? Of course, the answer is impossible. You have in San Francisco here, Silicon Valley, and you don't have social housing right nearby Apple, Google headquarters, right? You don't, do you? No. So that's what the socialist government tried about 11 years ago. Instead of having universities outside our cities in the highway 72.3.7 here in LA, you know the situation, on the contrary, let's have a university inside our dead city, the city that needs retrofitting. Let's have our headquarters, for example, this is a media pro company, this is Indra, they do satellites, they do software. These people, they have two papers, the rights of soccer with Barca and the rights of soccer of Madrid. That's all they do. Taking care of rights. But rights is the new gold. Maybe rights is the new gold. We don't have steel, we don't have concrete, we don't have mining. This is not our business. Our economy is soft, and soft is becoming hard. So I do believe that this economy of knowledge is somehow happening. Talking to people like Israel Ruiz back at MIT, he's not saying that the main turnover of the MIT economy is the economy of knowledge. He's saying 70% of his turnover is still real estate. So the number one business of that university is real estate, land, buildings, constructions. This is where we are. It's the generation that you will you will become as architects of the economy of knowledge, but still the real estate is there. What's not good about this is that, for example, this building weighs 1,000 kilos per square meter. This building 900, 860, 1,200, 180. Turak Bar by our dear friend Jean Nouvel is still also 890 something kilos per square meter. Our program, our office program is 250 kilos of a square meter, and we are doing buildings of 1,000 kilos per square meter. We're doing four times the mass, the material, the energy embedded that we do need. So the first attempt of the Media City building was to do, let's do 250 kilos per square meter building, construction weight, material, energy, traveling, footprint for a 250 kilos per square meter program. Let's do something one-to-one. All right, you follow me? So this building is four times lighter than this building, which means 60-70% less foundations, which foundations in Barcelona are 2.5 million euros. So instead of spending all this concrete, sorry if there is some industrial concrete here in the room, but it's not our business anymore. But clearly, 2.5 million euros on foundation, 70% savings on that is 1.2, even a Friday, I'm still doing some maths. 1.2. What's the cost of my skin? The skin that you with your students are doing so much work over it as a pilot project. The cost of that skin is 1.2. So where does Enrique get the monies? Not to throw concrete into foundations. Lightness is this key word for you guys. Lightness. Light. And I did learn this with Alejandro de la Sota. You did mention that. That was fantastic. So lightness has been here for some time. So let's look at it carefully. When things are light, if you do a concrete building or a steel building, that is already 40% less kilos. If the steel is in compression, but rather in tension, that's already 25% less kilos. That's a 65% reduction quickly in a design decision. Your buildings could be 65% quickly lighter just by doing that. And if something is light, then you get on TV. And so he is the star, and he is doing this work, which is, in fact, navigating through these four engines, these four robots, these four machines that lift the building up in one day. So what we see here is 320,000 euros cheaper. Okay. So instead of doing an scaffolding and lifting floor by floor all the way up, on the contrary, we lift three floors up, the safety zone is 4 meters high, workers are work at not risk, and then in a day of a work, then you get this thing up. That's efficiency. The other concept I want to bring to you, and the inception second concept, is distributed. Instead of centralized, distributed, all right? This is a distributed structure. They all cooperate, they all work together. If one fails, the rest do the job. So that is a centralized solution. You see, if this collapse, the whole building collapses. We are a distributed society. We all have computers, we all have cell phones, we have a collective awareness, a collective authorship. I thought it was going to get built in Frankfurt, made in Germany, you know what I mean? But it was built and we did talk with you, Greg, we talked about this at the CCA. In fact, the new role of the architect, I mean, we talk about makers, everyone talks about makers, understood. But imagine if I give my design to the builder, and then the builder to the structural contractor, and then to the steel operator, and then to the welding technician, and then this goes on site to the welding technician. What do I get? What does my client get in this lost in translation? 10%? Do you agree with me? Out of what I design, going through this way, there is this obviously and this loss of precision, of complexity, of detail, and I'm not getting what my client is asking me for. On the contrary, on a Saturday morning, my office was sending the plot files to the machine directly. Okay? No meetings, no discussions, I like it, I don't like it, I don't understand, I understand. Okay? All that over. You get 20%, you get 20%, you get 20%, you get 20%, you get 20%. You don't risk, you produce employment, good. But I'm sending the files to the machine. This machine has an email, and I'm sending an email directly to that machine. Which means the architect has a very dramatic responsibility and role over construction. Yeah, are you with me? Yes? It means our fees are high. Yeah, no laughing, no, yes. Okay, what do you mean laughing? Guys, our fees are high because we are doing this. We are not the first designer, and sorry, I don't know what's happening. We are leading, all right? This, it's the only way, otherwise we're out. We are out, and we don't want to be out. So yes, it's risky because this building moves 20 centimeters at the very top when there is a heavy wind all the way, and you know, like, what is resolution? And as you see, every of these bars, there is 18 different thicknesses, so that what I said to the client here was, if you spend 80,000 euros in our fees, you will save 320,000 euros on steel. The client is a public institution, and they were telling me, oh, Enrique is coming with another of these pokers. You know, like, some tricky happening. So I said, it's true. If you give me 80,000 euros so I can work with my engineers and I can calculate bar by bar each of the poles, each of the knots, I'm not going to do one calculation and apply the thickness to all of them. I'm going to reduce 25% the weight of this structure. And with it, he said, I don't have an interest in the economy of steel. Anybody from steel here? Okay? It's not your night tonight, I tell you. So if anyone from steel here, sorry, but our business is our field. Right? Knowledge. Our knowledge. We work with biologists, it's a jellyfish. The building is a jellyfish. A jellyfish is not an animal, a jellyfish is a system. It has different brains, different muscles, different organs, different agendas, but it has a system. It's a platform where many of them live. So that's what happens when the light goes off at the Media City building. This is the European best steel structure building. Before this one, Richard Rogers got the one of the airport in Madrid. His building was 6,000 million euros. Our building is 24 million euros. Okay? Design is small, please. You get the same awards. You get the same awards, but a small project. Go deep, and then you get the award. All right? So the building is not about weight, it's about strength all the way up to get this. We have some workshops here with children where they enter this door and they say, something is missing. The good news, we have smart children. Good. The bad news, they are here recording all we do. It's really not obvious that a child of 10 years old moves in a building and says, where are the columns? Yeah, smart children, but they are recording all we do. So please act responsible. Yeah, it's about energy. Barcelona is going through a strong desertification weather condition. This is how much energy you get in southeast, southwest compared to north. Wherever you see a building in Barcelona that has the same technology in every of the elevations of the building is not considering 300% energy. That's crazy. So the manifesto is every elevation gets a different technology. And these are the different ways and how we are reducing. 80% of our consumption is AC condition. Our winter is 2 weeks. It's a joke, we have 2 weeks of winter. So it's all about air conditioning. Let's kill the air conditioning so we can reduce from 50% CO2 emissions. So that's our second skin, glass, and the ETFE cushion. The three layers, we want the natural light going in, but we don't want the heat, the ultraviolet light, which is captured inside the ETFE cushions itself. So they move one by one. There's a luxometer that makes them move distributed. So using this technology, we get to 36% reduction on CO2 emissions. We have been, I was here in 2002, with Olga, quite an amazing place. This is ETFE buildings, the Herzog and the Neuron project. The use of ETFE here is not about energy, it's about doing an iconic building. Here it's a little bit about energy, but water, steam, but it's again, it's about building an iconic building. So here, basically, the diagram of energy becomes a building. The energy performance becomes a building. We were at the on-site exhibition at MoMA with Terry Riley, and he saw our work, he saw the studio, one of these 2007 meetings in the studio at Cloud9. He said, well, somehow you're doing architecture and you're doing stage design and performance with Bob Wilson, but maybe this is one of these buildings where the architecture is the performance. So the performance is the building. And we built it. And here it is. Last time I was here doing the lecture, I was showing you the project. Just a quick shots of the project. And there was the exhibition where the model was there. These are vertical cushions. So if the building is hung, we have these vertical cushions all the way up, where we are able to produce a nitrogen fog inside these vertical cushions. So when the air conditioning inside the building really, really needs to operate, needs to shoot that freeze, and it's gonna say, sorry, Andre, this time we are using energy. And that precise moment, the building produces. This is a prototype on site. You see the shadow? The shadow that is being produced? Nitrogen is here, it's in our air, 70% of our air nitrogen. So this is 92. This is the building shooting all the way from the top. It's a 30-minute performance. It goes in 30 minutes. We go from transparent to translucent. By adding natural oil to it, it becomes heavy. So we do light buildings but heavy particles. Yeah, you follow? By doing that, light is being produced. Alright, so these are photos of really the peak of the summer, like really mid-July, mid-August. That's from the inside. That's the system. we created the system, and then the client certified the system with a private company, which is called Abur. They got the information of the energy performance, and at the very end, he called me and, okay, the cloud is working, get the cloud out. Yeah, we didn't think about it. So yeah, we were so focused in creating the cloud at some point, like, yeah, well, the cloud will last here 4 or 5 hours, good, but at some point we have to get it out. So we end up finishing the circuit, so yeah, we got it out. Now we filter the oil on the one hand, and then we release the nitrogen back in. We are consuming 3,000 euros of nitrogen per year on this system, which is for a 20,000 square meter building in Spinas. This is the other scheme where you see all the sensors. These are luxometers. We have about 600 sensors all over the place. The building is quite radical because the building does not allow the boss of the office to turn the lights on. All right, so you go in, and if this luxometer tells that at the desk, on the computer desk, on your table, 500 lux is enough, at 3 meters distance, it's not going to turn it on. As architects, we believe that once the building is finished, we give the key and bye-bye, right? Yes, no? Here in LA is the same, no? But we do have to care about the performance, so we'd rather monitor what's happening. And then we did this for 2 years. So after the finishing of the construction, we were for 2 years checking out results. This is the distributed system, 104 computers. These are the Arduino. You are using here at UCLA Arduinos, I guess. Yeah, good. So we decided to use them. They are great. They have no problems with maintenance. If people are telling you, I'm so scared about, use them. It's really, really great. Okay, very supportive. After 6 years, the building has no problem. These are the black box. The Arduinos are inside. They make a decision following the input. We got certificate A in terms of energy. You know, you have this here in LA, by the way. It's an energy certificate that we use in Europe. The Ministry of Industry, after 2 years of using the building, they give you a rating. So it's not like LEED or Global Green Council Europe, it's a ministry, it's quite a public. So now electric products are measured by this, cars are being measured by this. The School of AEA, where I'm teaching, is a building LEED. School in the world, D, okay. But this is hidden in the reception desk. By 2020, this has to be in front of your entrance on any public view. So Europe is going to face, we are the pilot project, yeah, but we don't want to be the only A building. That makes no sense. We want to live, maybe, perhaps, but what we don't want is to be alone. There is only 4 A certificate buildings in Europe still, right? So A means 92% reduction on CO2 emissions. You're a net zero building. You're very close to that. Sometimes of the year is 72, sometimes it's 95, sometimes it's positive power, but the average of the year is 92. So it's a net zero building, as we call it in Europe. All right? So it's really, the award we are most happy about it is that one. We build it with 1,234 euros a square meter. Because it's a public building, we had 2,000 euros a square meter budget, because, you know, public buildings we have more budget. I don't know here, but in Europe it's like that. But if the buildings I was criticizing are market cost and they have been built with this amount of money, I'm not going to be able to criticize them again, right? If I use 2,000. Yeah, it's a net zero building, but with 2,000, then what's the point? The point is to do a market cost building and net zero with that money. You are with him? Is it possible? Because what you hear is ugly buildings 20% more expensive. That's what you hear, yes? Engineers, well, it's sustainable, it's gonna take you 7 years to get the money back of the photovoltaic. No, that's what you hear, right? Well, what if that's the money I have, I'm gonna do a green building, net zero, from the very starting point? That's the agenda, yeah? So, how do we do these things? Well, by scripting, this is an Excel file, and this is our CAD plans. What was tricky here was, you know this building? This is the Ford Foundation, Kevin Roach Foundation in New York. You know this building, for sure. This building has an incredible world record on the impact of the vertical communication, the vertical core, related to the program that is being deployed. It's about 12%. Normally, a real estate person with 18-20% of impact of that communication related to the program. So we wanted to break this world record. Right? You know, when you are young in the office, let's break that world record. You know this feeling, yeah? So we did by designing the numbers. These are the numbers we like, and this is the architecture that supports these numbers. So instead of designing a plan and then getting performance, we were designing performance and getting a plan. This plan was very weird when we went to the client to show him that the stairs were going to be up and down and toilets on that corner and that corner. There was no core inside the building whatsoever. They were like, everyone knows, the core is in the center. And the offices are around the center. Yeah, but these are my numbers, 7%. One moment. It's interesting, it's in imbalance. The core is not in the center, it's interesting, right? So that's what's happening. Drive numbers, as designers, as architects, design with numbers. They're gonna help you a lot in your meetings. And as Neil was saying, we are architects that have to know about nitrogen, about ETFE, about green roofs, about photovoltaics, about wind turbines. The building is attached in a geothermal way to the sea. So when I am here in this terrace and I'm going out of my office and I see the sea, and I think about Greek boats sailing crazy. But what do I see in the Mediterranean Sea? I see that that sea is helping me because I know my building is connected and is sending water all the way there. That water gets cooled down, that comes to me. In my office, this little fresh air I see, I feel, is that sea. So I say, thank you. This is the civilization of empathy that Jeremy Rifkin talks about. All right? So, good luck as architects. You have system minds, yeah? And you're gonna do system projects, like we do. I believe on that. I do this lecture and sometimes they say, nice renders. I'm like, excuse me, the only thing fake is my mother here 40 times. my children 7 times. I am the orange guy here 4 times, whatever.
The renders.
What is real and what is fiction? Sorry. We get these things in the office. This is about 6 months ago. It's a Kuwait photo of a place. It's a high school place. First thing I said was, who sent them the plans? Excuse me. And then nobody sent them the plans. Then we contact them. I went there to see these people, to meet them. It's happening, okay? Smart children are taking knowledge, things in the web, and they are doing these things with paper, with wood, and all right, it's happening. we thought it was going to be a pilot project. Well, society is ready, and society is doing more than a pilot project. They are taking it very seriously. Now the city hall in Barcelona has occupied and is doing this master planning of what's called macroillas. So the mobility space, the space that once Cerdà designed for society, is now being taken over by society. So the citizens of Barcelona now own this space, and it's happening in a certain way related to us, to the media city. Again, these are social housing here. It's a social housing. This is Test Systems, the German company. This is social housing. These people live with 480 euros a month. They go down the street, they take the same bike I take, okay, Bithing, and these people make 5,000 euros per month, and they take the same bike as these 480 euro month people. This is the impossible agenda that Barcelona somehow is trying hard to do. Yeah? Okay? You see where Media City belongs to. Yeah? Okay? It's okay? We go on? It's interactive. All right. So this has not been published. This project has not is not out. Is not in my website. Is not published. It's not everywhere. It's like for the first time here, ever. I have very strong friends here: Greg, Neil, Sylvia, Nick Hafferman at Art Center, and I think Barcelona and LA are so close together, so aligned that I really wanted to do it here. So let's do it, okay? If we have a pilot project as an office building, okay, that's fine. But if we don't have a pilot project as a home in the coast, in the Mediterranean agenda, in Mediterranean culture, that's what happens. You have all the tourism that comes to us, and they are basically destroying our landscape, our culture, our territory, because, yeah, they want to invest, they want to have homes, we want to have homes, but which home? What case study home should we have? Since there's no pilot project, then it's a mess. Or it's, in fact, fake. Yeah. This house that looks Flintstones is 2 years old. Nothing wrong with the client, nothing wrong with the builder, but I think I'm hunting for this actor. Yeah. I have one. He's in LA, probably. He's Melrose Place, no? So, again, responsibility. If we are the number one cause of global warming, we should have a case study. So what I did was, the client came and said, I like very much your Vila Nur project, so let's do a second Vila Nur. And I said, whoa, Paul. Yes, it's going to be your private house, but it's going to be a case study. And this is because of visiting here some of the case study projects you have. I was here this morning again. The cost of that house, I heard today for the first time, was $35,000. And the retaining wall was $5,000. So the house was $30,000. And look what this house has become. Right? So, yeah, a case study is essential. And our Mediterranean culture has a lot of these situations where certain madness happens, and it is in our... What makes me be together with Greg a lot is this project we did. If we did it by ourselves, and that's it, is one scenario. But to do it and to talk to him about it and to understand that there is a dialogue, that there is a relationship, that to me, after all these years, is essential. So people like Coderre did a case study of the Mediterranean culture. People like Bonnet did La Ricarda. These landscapes really deserve the best yachts, okay? But also the best architecture. So here is Robin, the client. Here is, I didn't go with the client to the site, I went with my kids. This is 6 years ago. So mapping trees, checking the biodiversity of the place. Should we increase diversity, biodiversity? What is it? How we map it? What's essential? So we started saying, let's save the trees, let's save biodiversity. If we somehow jump over the landscape and we don't touch the landscape and we kind of build around it, on top of it, but not destroying it. So it was clear that we were not going to do a house, that we were going to do a distributed scenarios, performance and projects along the place. So it was not a house, but rather distributed architectures. So we start mapping conditions, wind, loads, all that we know, and we were somehow following the conditions of distance with the neighbors and so on, urban planning. We got to here, we got the first okay from urban planning as a design development, move on. So kind of volume, heights, it's not complicated, you know, to perform 20 rules of the urban planning. Urban planning at the end is 20 rules. It's really not difficult. So we got here, and that was the first model to kind of freeze. Okay, we are here. Once you say you are gonna save all the plants and all the species and so on, you do have to take care of these machines. They did destroy quite a lot that we were not expecting. All right, so that was quite a moment that we got quite angry. Yes, the tree. Yeah, but I hit the tree in the back. Sorry. All right, so yeah, that's planning. That's building. Okay, I'm saying this because today all this project wants to address this issue of design, being an architect, building on site. Hopefully I succeed. This was a great map the client gave us. Incredible. It's the first time a client comes to us, this is my house and I want to deal with all these topics from smart to geothermal to energy to... Great, no? Great starting point. No? What a brief, no? The best brief ever. what? They were working very hard at home. This was my best positive vitamins, positive drugs of the 5 year process. Like, are you spending your nights doing this? What? Before our model, okay? So, again, the construction moves earth, destroys earth, as low impact as possible, but once you get there, it's massive. These are photos of the office at the MidICT, because you see the situation, like looking at Villanurbs, being at MidICT, and kind of looking at this project's agenda, no? The studio is important, as this ecosystem where all projects are related. Well, this is a separate slide. I have some problems here. Okay, we'll go on. So what we decided to do with the structure was these mushrooms. These mushrooms that were only touching the landscape in 3 points, 4 points, 5 points, in order that nature could live under it. Thank you. is about 140 square meters into one structure, one component, one column. So nature operates under this. It's a garage, but it's the best studio of architecture. Look at the view, look at the place, the light. So what is inside this nature? It's still not being resolved, but we didn't want to touch path, animal life, roots. So we are like on top of it. You see, like, so what do we do now with this? Still, we still don't know. Still, we're still thinking how should we do. But that's what's happening, is that 80 square meters have only a position, a standing position. So nature fully runs under it. Yeah, okay. So this is about the mushroom structures. So what about next? Here it's about the Catalan vault. We have this great Catalan vault tradition in the Mediterranean. But before designing the Catalan vault, we know from the Catalan architects that the views are key in our landscape, in our territory. So we were scanning the views and designing very carefully these interfaces between publicness in and out. What are these interfaces? What are these glass windows? These are some tests to see what's going to be. What are the views? So you see here, we are scanning the silhouette of the mountain, and then we are replicating this edge at the center of the table. These are simulations. We have built a 3D scan. So we created that from the desk of the kitchen, like being here at this point, you could see the three views, and the sleeping place. It's calm, so without neighbors watching. So then the glass arrives, it's quite heavy. I mean, this, the weight of this is about 800 kilos to get to here. You see the other kind of architecture that is being placed there? I'm hunting this architect again. It's another one. So here we are. A lot in this collaboration of let's say robotics, membranes, people, teamwork on site. What's also happening is that there is no in and out. You see, like the sea goes through, and then there is this, we are out, this is in, but this is out again. So there's this ubiquitous landscape around home. So the Catalan vault has been here as a target in our Mediterranean architecture. This is the patent and some of the work that we have carefully looked at it. It is very expensive because it is very heavy. The woodwork you need to perform, the ceramic inside, outside, the concrete, the steel plate, the weight of it. So our agenda was, let's do a Catalan vault, but with fiberglass, extremely light membrane, extremely light surface. That was all the analysis. You know, when you do the first concept and the first analysis, everything is red. Not a little bit of red here on that corner, no. All of it. Right? So then you get a better performance, and you start to have less red at the edges. All right. So these are the components of the membrane. and it's a detection how the geometry deploys. These people have never done this. They do some projects for Airbus, the flight company. So yeah, fiberglass, yes, composite, but low resolution. So yeah, for Airbus, but low resolution, therefore low cost. It's a 6 millimeter fiberglass plate. With the help of wooden wooden structure that deploys and gets to here. These are these moments that, yes, we are doing the right thing. It really belongs to this place. It's rooted, it's indigenous. I mean, these are one of the things that we are discussing with Deep 18. You see, like, the relationship between landscape and architecture, the place, light, volume, lightness. It was great to be under this, I tell you, under construction like this, power of light. Mapping of the surface, relationship between the concrete and the surface. And what you see here is the relationship between the pavilion that we did with Art Center, the guest house, the pool, and this main living room. So when it is about energy, again, the house is a system. We are collecting the water. The number one problem in the Mediterranean is that we, as Barcelona is doing, we are bringing water from Italy. We are buying water from Italy. Imagine how mad is this. You are not doing well with water here, right? So we are together. You see, we are alive. Same problem. Where do you buy the water from? Yeah, the city. Up north. All right. But it's a big grid and costly. Our grid is losing now about 28% of the water inside the grid. Because it's a very old grid, obviously. So the first thing was, let's have enough water for a year as a self-sufficiency. We collect the water of the rain, and then we have the size of the storage is big enough to have a 1 year of life. Irrigation, garden life, pool, and so on. Water helps us to that's a video about the okay, so about energy. We are filling our membrane, not with concrete, but with insulation. 16 centimeters of insulation because of not having air conditioning. The house has no air conditioning. This thin layer of concrete is to protect the insulation. Inside your computer, inside your Google Maps, inside your Google Vault, inside your Google Drive. Get there, get on site. Society is waiting, society needs you. Get there, do it. Please do it. You can imagine the face of the neighbor. Yeah, who's wrong? That's the dialogue. They are talking to each other. am I wrong or you are wrong? There is a discussion for sure. Like they, Robin was now he lives, now he's been here operating, it works. He's been in the garden, no? He's like cultivating there some tomatoes in the garden, and some of his neighbors pass by and, excuse me, do you work here? Of course, Robin, yes. Is this a museum? Yeah, this is happening. It's also happening, people passing by and saying, 4 million euros. That's quick shopping, eh? It's like, it's not on sale, yeah? So there is a debate, you know? That's what is important, that people think, oh, this is the future, what is the future? What is next? Okay, so once we have the thin layer of the structure of the membrane, this does not work acoustically. This geometry acoustically doesn't work. So we have to have a ceramic inside that absorbs the wave of the acoustics in order to capture the inside performance. So I'm not going to tell you the glue we are using, okay? But it is like a glue. To map the laser beam into these geometries. This wall moves and closes and opens so that we see going through. That's how the light goes in and incorporate the wood frame into the project. This is the render we did. This is what we deliver. Before, after, okay? I do it again? So, it cannot be photographed. Maybe at the IDEO lab you have, maybe you can help us. Because we cannot, it is a space of performance that we are, we get these abstract landscapes. Yeah, okay. And the outside ceramic, because of course this layer gets very hot and is we need particles to reflect the sun all the way up. Here we were doing a lot of cresting, a lot of work. I'm not going to go into that. No, I know Esper. His name is Esper. See the secondary instruction to operate. This builder has done 18 homes in this area. Okay? All the homes that we are, the Flintstone homes, yeah? He has done the Flintstone homes. And the same people has done this one. So I think it's starting to, the outside ceramic is like leaves, and we have these leaves relationship. We like it to leave the edge open, this idea of deconstructing, so to kind of, it's open-ended. Interesting, the inside ceramic and the outside ceramic, how they collaborate, they talk to each other, how on-site, work on-site. Our job is from digital to real, from digital to real. Other people are interested in scanning our world inside our digital reality. I think our job is to move from digital to real, okay? As you know, a lot of companies are not interested in space condition. You don't have to go to the meeting, you can do a Skype and then you don't go to it. You don't go outside because we can do a Skype. This denies a space. You can do Dropbox and you can, that denies the meeting. You can do, but that also denies being together, being in place. A space is at risk, seriously. My students know we are going to fight these companies because space is our condition, is our design condition. We are making for the space. All right? Water again, dealing with water inside, so water is our main source of energy, cooling the place, warming the place, bringing light to the place. Oh, here I start my explanation on the relationship with Cloud9 and Art Center, College of Design. You know, like, imagine you guys, UCLA, this is the industry is doing okay, because it's the number one economy in the world, construction, 20% of global GDP, 25% of global GDP in Europe. How is it here? Construction is the biggest economy in the world. Not the army. But you know this, no? You know that the biggest economy in the world is not a country, it is construction, the biggest industry. It's not IT. It's not Apple. You know this or not? There's no economy in UCLA. You're not studying economy? No? Not Friday night, I understand. Okay. So, what if we have the labs aligned with the builders and the offices of architecture? What could happen? What could happen if inside a construction we ask a school of design to design and build a piece of work that enables a relationship? What we cannot do is that you guys are here in this education bubble, and then there is the construction bubble, and then there is the real estate bubble, which is fully collapsing in London, for example. We must have the academia, the research, and the construction working together. Do you agree? You want to agree, or you want to play a role, or you want to stay in the bubble? Sorry. You like the bubble? So, that's the project. This is one of the first prototypes there. There is David, James, different teachers, Jason, some of the students there. very excited because we are getting things real. This is how we got organized, like this will be done in Art Center in Pasadena, this will be done there in Barcelona. At the end it's a very easy Excel file and that's it. This is the project we did agree to perform. We did the structure analysis because at the end it's our responsibility. If it breaks, if it falls down, it's all under my name, under my shoulders. This is what my engineers resolved, that we had to have these steel bars crossing the corners, and we refused to do it this way. So again, you are going to have a lot of fights. You know this, no? You know this already, no? You're going to fight your engineers. But there is always a chance, a possibility. These are great images I was collecting these days of this is Victor and Manolo from my office working with a student Wen coming from Art Center. The white thing is marketing, okay? It's to look like together, okay? And wearing the hat, I don't know, that's also marketing. It's like she's very into it. The collaboration was, these are really professional workers and these are no crew workers. So they're working together. And we got the boxes from LA, and this is when they arrived. They didn't know if north was north, south was south, so just a kind of a first shot. That was a bit of a surprise. And this is a bladder, we inflated the bladder. Our mold is the bladder, all right? And we are using this as a wood form on top. The slides are going to be jumping in and out, all right? This is the moment where the architect arrives and is like doing some questions, what's going on here, there, and so on. It was very nice to see this up, like inflating. You see there is no, this was built here in LA. It was great to be inside. They are installing dots. So the bladder has this parametric design where you see dots already being plotted on the fabric, on the PPT textile, and then they are placing these pieces of wood on each of the. This is me like playing nuts with Jason. Just to bring energy to the rest, like, oh, the architect is doing something, okay, good. He's on board. This is a very critical night where nothing worked, where we are all very depressed, you see all the heads down, long day, what the F? And David leading the F, like, all furious, but doing a great work together again. These are the inflatable units. So one is the backup of the other. It has to operate at 1,000 Pascal pressure. You see we are getting to 1,726. That is really a rock, so that allows the bladder to support this. And you see all these wood panels are going to be the windows later on, the space holders for the windows. And at the end somehow, yeah, we did it, we are happy. It's kind of a collective piece of work at this point. Give them an applause, right? Come on. They did great. Some of the work is also the hydroponics that was also prototyped. I don't go into detail. But you know what happened? That our center went back. They had to leave. So after. We thought that it was going to be accomplished in 10 days, but 10 days was phase one. So our timing there, not so good. So they left. What we did was we published this in the news to kind of bring up the energy. So a failure turned into a very good press article. All right. So yeah, it's a success because at the end somehow, he created the 22 Arroba district, so he was meeting with the teachers at the Art Center. Here you see James, Jason, so this kind of Media City studio photos. We did an exhibition, an opening in the studio of the work of the students, and Areti, you know, what is it called? Yeah. Areti, the director of IAC, as you know him, you know her well. Olga, David from our center, at the end of this moment, like, we will succeed. But they left. Mm. Thank you very much. So there we are alone on site. Back to the job, like, okay, guys. Wrong timing, but let's finish. Let's do it. So we changed the crane, so because it was very heavy, and slowly, one by one, maybe quite slowly, we got to the place where now both things are mapping precisely. So here, this is the moment where we are shooting concrete inside the two layers through the bar. The concrete has fiberglass inside, so instead of doing the steel bar with corners in the corner. So what, you know, what drives the image later, we can remove this layer, this wood plate. Have a very, very thin 8 centimeters of a concrete membrane. The bladder, the woodwork, the textile, all together was $8,000. So it was hard, and you do have to be an architect standing there on top of the thing, smelling the concrete, understanding that concrete has a temperature, concrete is a, is a chemical performance fully, so go on site again, please. Send concrete here, that they're doing some instructions quickly. These are the testing of the concrete that has always to be part of your certificate. The resistance is being cast there, and this is how we are shooting the concrete in, and how you see it inflated of a liquid chemical concrete formula. Is it right? So all the way here, then we take away the panels, and we break the textile. Builder with his marketing, the drones moving in. All right, we've seen this. Good. All right, so you see how the pavilion deploys. The next was, how are we going to put together these plexiglass windows and the concrete? So we have been using this silicone design profile that is also being used in trains, also some car design. We did the milling over the plexiglass so that the sun was not going through, but the landscape of the plexiglass was interesting. This was done inside the studio of Jason. First window, 4 or 5 windows, a landscape inside. What we did is 2 plexiglass together, and between the 2 plexiglass, it's a bio resin. So it's a resin that is built out of pine trees. So we are taking this resin of the pine trees and we are using it to laminate the windows. So windows, lamination, glass, how it's integrated in the place, in the landscape. We're very happy that it's has this performance. It's a space of meditation. It's a good place to run up. We're using it as a music place, like to hear music strong. So I think this, I have this image here because when Bucky Fuller had the helicopter moving the dome, yeah? Yes, no? This historical moment. We did it without the army, yeah? Yeah. Okay, guys? So, all right. I have a couple of quick folders and I'm going to show 5-7 minutes of a good foundation to give you an update. What I like to talk here is quickly about human performance. Nick Haverman came to the studio. This is the mayor of Barcelona. It's about teamwork. It's about risk, people risking. It's about the mayor being aligned with the house. So guys, you do have to go to see mayors to discuss with them, to get, give them some books and so on. It's about people like training in the studio. It's about this collective authorship. The architect is carrying all these pens on the pocket. Don't forget this, this is a very important detail. You have the pens, you are the boss. And you have to wear brown, they wear brown, so you wear pants brown, but then white or black. All right, that's the strategy. Always be on the phone, always. Then you are the architect. Then do drawings on site. This is essential. The drawings, yeah, we forgot the drawings, you know, like some people are going on site with their cell phone and yeah, everything is here. Excuse me, what? What is here? What? The what? Sorry, what? Do drawings. Drawings are essential. The builder always has his hands in the back. This is very important. This is if you wait until the end to do a party, it's a disaster. You won't make it. Try to do some parties in between. Some happy moments like, oh, we got it, yes, celebrate selfie. Oh. Yeah, it's essential. Eh? It takes time, and the mayor coming again on site all the time to do photos. And I like to show this image because of Mark. Mark was here, the project architect, and he learned a lot, and we struggle, and we fantastic work. Yeah, this image is because, you know, like, you have seen, no, these workers, these people doing the construction. We brought some, what's that? No, Rocker, no. We brought, what's the name of the glasses again? The Oculus Rift. We brought some Oculus Rift. This was Alberto in the office, and he gave this Oculus Rift to the workers. So we were only doing the first kind of drawings and sketches over the landscape, and they could see what they were going to build, right? And seriously, taking the Oculus Rift after that, they cry. Seriously. People who are 62 years old are still working there and kind of finishing the work, and they said, we thought we were not going to see this. This was not us. We are doing these boxes, these houses, like boxes, the Flintstones. So we thought this was not us. All right? So there is a lot of society there waiting for us to kind of retrofit or bring technology to them in a good way. Go on site, be on site, discuss on site. I cannot tell you this more and more and more. Do some work in the school, okay? But go on site. This is dedicated to the photographer because I hate his top shots like this. you see the builder, the architect, the young architect. Okay, thank you very much, Jordi. Thank you for this. My family. Essential, key, great. And people like Jane Burley at RMIT coming and and yeah, the world is crazy, and we are all together. The house is together with the mountain, but it flies, but it maps landscape, produces a Mediterranean ecosystem, it breathes. These lemons are for gin tonics. No, it's true, eh? No. So, yeah. We don't go Walmart to get the gin tonics. We grow the gin tonics. So, and one grandmother from the family with us came to me visiting this, and there is a relationship between the house and the mountain. Eh? You didn't tell me, yeah, but there is, eh? I know. And then it's like, people are ready, society is ready, they are seriously taking this, embracing this, and enabling this to be real. It's real. Like in joy and full performance. Good? All right, so I'm going to show you a bully, and that's the end. So, who doesn't know a bully, I'm going to show you a quick video of what they do.
Thank you. right.
This is El Bulli team. The place we were saying, where is it so far? So it's a 1 hour and a half way from Barcelona. It's quite a place, it's quite a territory because the mountains are going into the sea, into that national park. It's a protected place. We have been in our RV going through all these national parks you have here. It's fantastic, extraordinary. So this is one of the top best Catalan national parks that we do have. The seaside and El Bulli is right here. This is the restaurant. This is the location. It's well rooted. It's an indigenous place. So let's be indigenous. Ferran was, we know each other for 12 years, and in these 6 years on this project he was. So what is architecture today? You know? Let's audit the situation. What is architecture? Well, we have kind of architecture that is really open and creates these big surfaces. It's using membranes like Fraiotto's work and Cicerubán. And we do have some strategies like the Misma de Roy Pavilion, where you have spaces, pavilions, breaking. And you have this architecture like in the Mediterranean, where boxes are like Caracas Village. And some architects did start to enjoy the curve of the landscape and how to integrate it. And people like Toyorito, like Vicente Guayar, people who did Escofidio Renfo, where they are saying the cloud is the building, the mountain is the building, the landscape is the building. And maybe there is some science there, there is some idea that architecture is particles, that architecture is this possibility of physics, like this physics of the 70s. So we got together to start the project. Okay, you see the two stars together, okay? But maybe the star is this technology somehow that allows us to move from this romantic postcard to another reality. All right, so as you know, you can get into it deeply, high resolution, deeper into it, more and more detail and more particles. So basically, we turn that image, that postcard, into 9 billion dots of particles, of dots, of information. So we have the trees, the leaves, the place, the corner, that space, that Bulli photo became a 3D file. Yeah, okay, understood? So if it is a 3D file, we can go into it and we can navigate. We can operate. We can be on site. From branches to leaves to steps to wooden to rocks. Is it right?
Yep.
So if we have information, if we have this 3D scanning, but we do also have sensing, like photosynthesis, CO2, salinity, humidity, geothermal, this thing together, we can do a section through. So the sea is here, the salt is coming because of the wind. We have geothermal, we have the wind, we have the plants, the trees, architecture, is this traffic of particles being here. We see the cars producing some pollution right here. And we are particles. We are water, 80% of us, so we are particles. And all together is this traffic. And then the sun arrives and wow. So architecture has to navigate, operate, traffic, generate, discuss, enable what happens between me as particles and the weather as particles and the landscape as particles and the architecture as particles. So this is the thesis we brought to the Biennale of Venice in 2012. So architecture is out of these conditions. nitrogen, and Ferran was saying to me, if I cook with nitrogen and you do nitrogen skin buildings, we are okay. We are talking the same. This is a dish for them. This molecular thing is a dish, all right? So if cooking is molecular and nature is molecular, then shouldn't we do El Bulli Foundation Architecture molecular, so that everything is one, is the same language, is the same reality, they can talk to each other and so on? What if? So we did these presentations of what the Bulli Foundation, this is the biggest project we did, that's the third project, and we did exhibitions about it and so on. One thing I like to show to my students is that they have to get to activism. If you are on site and architecture is a policy and we are socialists, social activists, we do have to get to, you see this, no? I love a new Bulli, you see this? And this is the work of kids like this, like Joan. You have seen him jumping into the pool already. But this is my studio in the back. On the one hand, this is the crazy reality we live now. I am the architect of this project, okay? Yes, no, you know this already. But I am a member of the ecological party against this project. So are you gonna do a good job? Yes, I will do a good job. Be patient. We are watching you. Clearly. So I am against my project and designing my project. So when we started, So when we started this project, this is the construction, the permit, so we have it now, finally. We are retrofitting the existing building. Changing the wood structure carefully. This is the work sharing. It's a new building attached to it. So this is about 2 months ago. It's a very thin steel structure. You see the place. You see the beauty of the landscape. And we've done some demolition. Now we have moved up the structure. It's, all the trust are hung from. We are learning from ocean life and sea life and how we can operate, learning about this phenomenon. This is a building which is called brainstorming. It's the brain of the foundation. It's where they are going to do early meetings every day, the 25 crazy people of the team. We plan to grow more. We plan to have some Arduinos around so that they talk to each other. It's again, it's the idea of collective distributed intelligence. Things we learn at BJCP that we are going to apply here. So this was the image of the newsletter. This is the work now. We are full. We are ending now the fine folding. What this is and how the wireframe structure analysis. We believe that we are in this endless house or this agenda. It's true that people who are helping us, like Technalia, they believe in these technologies of out of particles. These are photosynthesis. These are photovoltaic panels out of particles. If you have a panel like this, it's not going to operate, it's okay now, it's okay, it does a good job. If this is curved, well, it's okay, it's better, but then the efficiency of it. If it's a circle, it's always perpendicular to the ray, right? So this is the kind of particles that are starting to happen, like microalgae too. Yeah, that was the first photo, was the two of us, now we have more white hair than that photo. We're pushing strong to make it happen. So I'll leave you with this last image. We talk a lot about the smart architecture. So the trees know where the water is. The tree knows where the wind is. The tree knows how to mutate. The tree knows. And what if we can take the information of the tree and that the tree runs the building. Okay? The tree is saying to the building, it is the night, turn the lights on. Because the building knows. If we do that, we will create this empathic performance, empathic behavior in landscape and architecture, where the tree is the boss, not the architect, not Ferrari, not the client, the tree. Thank you very much.
Questions, anyone?
Who's the lucky resident of the house?
Robin, Colin, Priska, and a dog. Yeah. It's a family. They want to keep it secret. It's not being recorded. Yeah. It's a family that has had a very open dialogue with us. They didn't hide the bread, they show us the bread. And we show them that we were destroying a couple of trees too. So that became a quite a strong glue, and they were patient because it was supposed to be 3 years, but it turned to be five. The budget was on budget, was their investment. So. They are open to be a case study, so we can go there because of them, because they like it. Thank you. No, it's not 5 years of building, because one thing is from the first meeting to swimming in the pool, that is 5 years. Construction is a 2 year shot. But what do you want? What do you need? What is your program? What? It takes time. Culture needs time, and we have time. In terms of investment, they bought the land for €500,000. The construction is €1.2 million, and believe it or not, in the middle of the construction, people were trying to buy it for €4 million. So. Don't worry, there is time. And maybe you don't know you have time, but you.
Was the client informed of the history
of the case study? Yes, a lot. That's why the first year was talking about case studies. So, do you agree that students of architecture will knock the door and will go in on a Thursday morning and, well, let's get organized, you know? But yes. And do you know that this house now is going to be a pilot project so other people will know where your bedroom is and so on? So yeah, it took a year to understand this transparency, and we talk about the IMS a lot, we talk about Neutra, and as I said, he doesn't want to show up, seriously. It's not this kind of thing. But, yeah, when I was at Princeton doing this lecture, they were recording the lecture, no? And I was like, guys, what are you going to do with this recording? No, we are just going to bring it online and start sharing. How much you pay to be here? How much they pay me to do this? Are you crazy? Do your parents know that you're going to send these videos up there, online? Yes, because we live by sharing. Okay. So there's no other way than transparency. Somehow, you know, it's interesting, I think. A long economic question? It's Friday night, man, be careful. Dear Robin, please. This is one of my students at...
You mentioned about that you told the client that you're making them more money by saving the structures, and you take a portion of it for your profit.
No. That's a way to look at it, but that was not the case.
Yeah, yeah. Let me finish my question.
Please.
And also, you mentioned about that we architects at the moment are living in a bubble. We are a bubble, construction a bubble, and development a bubble.
Yeah.
And the way we can, like in this bad economy world, we have to break out this bubble and to step into the area to make up more profit. And you did it by creating more value from the energy point of view, construction point of view by saving them energy bills. So my question is, what kind of other factors or approach, including energy and construction, do you think will be able to create more value for developers and for the client, so therefore we can share a margin from it?
If we should share a margin from their profit?
Yeah,
it's a good question. No, very good, perfect. I believe our business is design, right? For a developer, their business is developing, right? We want to be well paid, we want to produce employment, we want to have resilient studios. I don't think we should have a part of their profit. We can be partners. I think there is some good examples of some projects where they pay us a fee, but at the same time we are with shares in the new company that's being created. So we can share risk. I'm not sure about sharing their profit.
My question is not about directly sharing their profit, but by stating that we are actually
creating lots of added value to you, so therefore we can charge more. My question is, in what way, including energy bill point of view, can we do this job?
I am thinking in an economical way on the construction, on the budget, on the energy performance, on the patents that are being produced in terms of innovation, but we have to stop and then let them have their authorship and their risk and their relationships. When Robin got this offer of someone saying, I'm going to buy the house for 4 million euros, it was a critical moment. He called me like, what should we do? And I said, you talk to your family the same way you did with the bread, talk to the family and see what do you want to do. It's important that we don't mix targets or agendas with a developer. I don't do light buildings for the developer, I do light buildings for the global warming scenario. Right? But he profits about it for sure. Yeah, you see, but it's they are aligned. If you're a green developer, you are aligned with the same agenda. Yeah.
I think maybe I'll just ask the last one.
Please.
So it's a pilot project, which is not just simply an open house. It's supposed to be a model for other projects. It sends the messages of antagonism to the Flintstone houses. Here's the way architecture should be done, mimics the landscape and so forth. The California project was two things. One, it was about transparency and openness in a different way in which the family would exist. That's, to my mind, why the case study house didn't work, because everybody wanted privacy. But the other part of it was about prefabrication. And you have a largely, handmade house on site. It seems as though the shell and the dome could have been a complete structural system with insulation and skin and all that, but you chose to do it on site. Was that because of labor? Was it because of wanting to get your fingernails dirty.
Yeah.
And what ultimately is the pilot message of that project?
If we are able to change, it's a small change, no? But if this builder now with these old workers have seen another way of doing architecture, that's really positive. At the same time, Coder and this tradition of the Catalan vault it has been forbidden or forgotten or by the modernist, maybe the modern push of some Catalan architects, no? So it's very important that we connect to these roots again, that we bring this to today's. I believe that other industries will take our point and will move forward. Maybe it should be more prefab. The idea of a prefab architecture 100%, I'm not very, very optimistic. Cars can, planes can, boats can, but I think architecture has this root ultimately, this orientation, this condition. So, yeah, let's have the arts and crafts of ceramics, new bio resin, no? Let's have that on site. We don't want to forget the fact of building on site. I think this idea that it's being produced in a workshop, and it is anchored, it's placed, 100% of it, we will lose a little bit the seed, no? The seed of an architecture that grows. It's my take. But yeah, how to operate as a pilot is what we need to do the coming years. Yeah, fully agree.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you very much.